So hello and welcome. Happy Friday. Welcome to another question and answer video for backyard beekeepers. This is episode number 85. Outside, the temperature is 56 degrees Fahrenheit right now, and that is 13.333 Celsius. So what you saw in the opening sequence is the yellow jackets are pinging all the beehives. If you notice, a couple of them even got right in the entrances. So keep your guard up, put your entrance reducers on, and keep those entrances restricted, because on these warm days, everything is in a fever pitch to get out there and get everything they can. And the yellow jacket queens that we saw chewing away on honeybees, those are honeybees that were dying anyway, that are often in the grass, or they're just really cold in the morning sitting on the landing board for some reason or other. They never made it inside the hive. And those queens are still after protein, so that tells me that they're still feeding some of their larvae. Even though we've had freezing temps, we've had snow already. So anyway, if you want to know what we're going to talk about today, please look down in the video description below. Also, if you want to join us for discussions on Facebook, please follow the link that's also down in the video description, and you can go there and share your pictures, your ideas. You can ask immediate questions that get answered by a bunch of knowledgeable beekeepers, and the environment is super friendly. No questions are too basic, no topics too sophisticated, lots of interesting stuff going on there, and people are really sharing photos of their hive configurations from all over the world, and let me tell you what, that's some impressive stuff. Anyway, what else can we talk about? We're going to list all the questions down below, so you'll see line item by line item. The first person, because this is something that we're doing on every video now, the first person that puts together the time codes to each of these questions that we're going to talk about today and post them in the comments section, that gets to be the pinned comment. There's a couple of people that are competing for that, and I really appreciate those of you who are taking the time as you watch this to write that down and do it. And this applies to any of my Q&A videos, past, present, and future, that do not have a comment with all the different timestamps associated with each individual question. So if you want to go into the background, look up one of the other ones and do that, and then I see that comment pinned to the top, so you get to be noticed and you're helping everybody out. Fellowship of Beekeeping. So what else do you need to know? If you have a question, please write it down in the comment section below or follow the link that's also in the video description, which takes you back to my website, thewaytobee.org, and you will be able to post your own question by filling out a form that comes to me. And some people want to be anonymous. I completely get it. Totally fine. I will still, if it's a good question and applies across the board, we might talk about it one of these Fridays. Oh yeah, and I have to say, this is the way to be. So let's get started. Jump right into it. The very first question, and this is part of my title, hopefully, today, that I've been wrong about oxalic acid vaporization. I know. Then I get this question, does it matter what OA to use? OA is oxalic acid. It gets delivered to the bees as a control measure for the varroa destructor mite, which is the number one culprit in everybody's beehives. They bring so many viruses and disease. They attack your bees. They attach themselves to the bees. They reproduce under your capped pupa, in with your pupa, under the cappings. They reproduce and have a good old time. They go after the drones most often. So we have a lot of methods devised to go after them. The very first of which, of course, is to get bees that can fend them off. Bees that groom them off, that bite their feet. There's ankle biters. There's all these different Purdue ankle biters. There's all these different lines of bees that are varroa resistant, that are hygienic bees, which means they pull off the caps of the cells that have developing pupa in them that might have the varroa destructor mite present. They bite those out, pull them out, chuck them on the landing board. I see that frequently with my BeeWeaver line of bees. But now here's the thing. I have always had, in fact, I don't have my oxalic acid here with me, but I always just went shopping for oxalic acid crystals. You know, I just bought whatever I thought was the purest. 99.5% pure oxalic acid, and that's what I was getting. A lot of you that are brand new may not know that this method of varroa control gets delivered through a dribble, a spray on packages, or even a vaporization, which really is a sublimation, because it goes directly from a solid state to a gas state without that intermediate state, which is liquid. And that's what I do, oxalic acid vaporization or sublimation. But what I really want to talk about, and what this really brought to my attention, is that you can't just use any oxalic acid crystals. It's frequently sold as wood bleach, if you want to look that up. And I see a lot of YouTubers and beekeepers, they just get the little plastic thing of wood bleach and they go for it. It's crystal, and they think oxalic acid is the same everywhere. Oxalic acid is new in the United States as an approved treatment for varroa destructor mite control. And actually, it's timely because this time of year, your brood numbers are low. For those of you who have not been able to treat and you find the need to treat for varroa mites based on counts. Don't just randomly treat your hives with oxalic acid or any other treatment, as far as that goes, just because it seems like the thing to do, just to make sure, you know, because what we can do is we can damage the bees. We can injure the queen's ability to reproduce. There's a lot of side effects if you overuse any of even the natural, perceived natural or organic applications, which oxalic acid falls under because it's an acid that's ubiquitous in the environment. It's in kale, it's in rhubarb leaves, it's in a lot of different plants, and it's always in your honey, by the way. But here's the thing, when it got approved for use on your bees, first of all, you can't expose your bees to it when you have honey supers on, because it's not approved to be ingested by people, and honey ultimately may be ingested by people, so you have to have your honey supers off when you treat. The other thing is, it's actually illegal to use oxalic acid. I know, it's illegal to use oxalic acid crystals that are not specifically labeled as a pesticide to be used with honeybees targeting the varroa destructor mite. It goes under AP Bioxal, I may pronounce that wrong, API Tech BIOXAL. So you might be wondering, well, if it has to be approved, it has to be, number one, the oxalic acid that you get has to be registered by the EPA under a label developed by the USDA. So if the oxalic acid that you're about to use on your beehives is not labeled that way and is not specifically identified as a, you know, a varroa destructor mite killer, then you're not legally using a product. So where do you get it? Well, so as soon as I learned that, which by the way, I learned this last week myself, that it has to be labeled like that. And it was actually part of the approval process for us being able to use oxalic acid in the first place. BetterBee.com, BetterBee.com, is a veterinarian-owned company, and they are one of the suppliers that is carrying the oxalic acid crystals that are approved. I ordered mine right away to get theirs, because here's the thing, apparently there are trace elements, trace materials, trace chemicals in the oxalic acid when it's being sold for wood bleach that may not necessarily make it onto the label. So if you want to feel safe, and we all do, I hope, we want to do the best we can for the bees. So what we expose them to, we want to make sure that it's approved for use on the bees. So I started doing this last year, and I was using regular, just what I thought was the best quality oxalic acid I could find. But now I find that what I did was illegal. So anyway, I'm sharing it with you. So again, you can do the dribble method using 1-to-1 sugar syrup. Normally people would do that in the spring, but in the springtime, your varroa numbers are low. When are your varroa numbers going to be the highest? Right now. Going into the fall, unless you've treated already, unless you've got some kind of treatment method, oxalic acid either has to be delivered in a series of applications because it doesn't work when they're in the pupa state underneath the capping. So you need to cycle it enough so that it's used for that and make sure that on the third cycle that you have eventually exposed every bee in that colony to the oxalic acid that condenses on the surfaces like a powder and condenses on the bees and attaches itself everywhere. By the way, it doesn't matter if you put it in the top of the hive, bottom of the hive, side of the hive. It goes everywhere evenly. I did a video showing exactly where it goes and how it happens and what the bees do while that's going on. And then it settles. So actually on your treatment date, there's a treatment effect that carries on for quite a while. So because it's a residue that sits on everything. So a lot of people have asked, well, how long do I have to wait before I put my honey supers back on? Well, what's the purpose of the honey super? First of all, is it for the bees or is it for you? If it's for the bees, it doesn't matter. You can put it right back on. There is a hold-off amount according to the method that's approved. Remember, I'm telling you what the strictest guidelines are because I feel that I'm responsible for making sure that I'm telling you good stuff. Do not treat during honey flows. Wait 14 days, so wait 2 weeks after your final treatment to add the honey supers on, if it's for human consumption. Now, of course, the kind of relaxed thinking has been that, from lots of high-end researchers and scientists dealing with bee culture and bee biology and everything else have said, it's really that residue isn't going to show up on tests anyway, and so forth and so on, and the residues are low, and it's not dangerous to people, and things like that, but we can't say that because we're not qualified to say that. I'm not personally qualified to say that you can relax that standard. It has not been approved. Therefore, you can't use it in a way that's not approved. So, there's that. So, get the stuff wherever you get your oxalic acid crystals. Maybe it works better, maybe it doesn't. The person that asked this question didn't want to be named, so I thought that was interesting, and that's okay. But it is a good question to be asked. I'm glad it was asked because it caused me to look deeper, and I did find out that I've been doing it wrong. So, and this time of year, by the way, when your brood is at the smallest, between November and December, and we get these warm days like today, the bees are flying, that means their cluster's broken. If you have not done an oxalic acid treatment, and you're counting mites, and you know that your mite levels are high, what's high? Well, you know, if you get 1, 2, or 3% mite load, 3 mites per 100 bees, 2 mites per 100 bees, you would want to consider maybe an intervention treating, because we can't do any of the biological methods of treating now. We can't do a split, which breaks the brood cycle. We wouldn't be putting in drone frames and things like that and pulling those out to pull out the mites with it, because you could lose a third of the mite load just by pulling out drone frames, capped drone. And so all those methods are gone, but now you would have maximum efficacy, maximum efficiency with little or no capped brood in your hive. So now all the mites are exposed and you can kill them off in wintertime. So, and I'll put a link down in the video description to that specific approved oxalic acid. Maybe it works better. See, I don't even know if it would work better because I've never tried it. Gonna have it for the next time I need to do it. So, and your most effective treatment, by the way, is a single treatment when there's no brood. So there you go. Next question. Mr. Dunn, I like your videos. This is from Jason. After some time evaluating, have you found the BeeWeaver bees to be as mite-resistant as their reputation? Have you needed to treat them to keep them healthy? Okay, here's the other part of when we're taking care of backyard bees. Even though you may only have a couple of hives, keep records, write everything down. We think we're going to remember everything, especially when we only have a couple of hives, so we just fly by the seat of our pants and, you know, give them names. And next thing you know, you've got 3 or 4 hives, 5 hives, 6 hives, and you might not remember exactly when you did different things. One of these is when it comes to counting mites. So, and I'm coming up, I'm playing around with a new method for doing that, by the way, which I can't tell you about yet. Obviously, we need to be aware of the mite load on the bees, and it builds in the fall. They build whenever there's a pile of brood being generated. So early spring, like coming into spring, you would have a low mite count. And as the bees increase their numbers, what's happening? A lot of reproduction. What else are they generating? A lot of drones. Well, when they do that, then the mites reproduce, a lot of mites compound, and then it's more and more of them. BeeWeaver bees, which are not the same as our weaver, by the way, because some people have written me and said, hey, BeeWeaver does sell packages. You know, it's our weaver, whatever. That's a different company. That is not the BeeWeaver Survivor Line stock that's varroa resistant, hygienic, and so on. So, are they good? Well, 2 out of 5 of them, that I have here required some varroa mite treatment. Now I have my thoughts about that because, first of all, I kept the weaver bees treatment free for 10 years. Last year I started to treat. The results were so good by doing moderate treatments that we got the mite levels way down. But then I realized I might have actually been working against my own bees. How was I doing that? Well, I brought in other lines of bees besides the weaver bees. So in particular, I did catch a couple of swarms of unknown origin because they're not from my own apiary. And I went deep into the woods and got those and started one and put it in a satellite apiary in a town called Harbor Creek. By the way, I live in the northeastern United States, the state of Pennsylvania. And so the one in Harbor Creek was a feral swarm that I collected deep in the woods, many miles away from me. And the good news is, of course, I put them where they were away from my own apiary, because it's another thing that we're looking at biosecurity-wise, is if you're not collecting your own swarm, like I catch my swarms right in the trees, right in my own property that emit from my own colonies of bees. So that's my own stock. So I'm recycling and keeping my own stock. The issues come into play when you buy in bees. For example, if you get a nucleus colony of bees or you get packaged bees and things like that, you're introducing new lines and genetics into your own backyard apiary, but they also may be bringing diseases, pests, varroa mites, small hive beetles. Some people told me when I sent them to somebody to get packaged bees that were without queens, several of those people that I sent to that source told me not only did they come loaded with mites, they also came loaded with small hive beetles. So these are all things that can impact your resident bees if you already have an apiary with colonies in it. Whenever you bring in new stock, you should keep them actually well away from your own bees for now. So if you can find a satellite location, maybe a friend that doesn't have bees but they have property, that would be a good place to intermediately stage and care for the bees that you've brought in until you really know their traits, strengths, weaknesses, whether they have a load of some kind of pathogen, whether they, you know, they might be sick bees. They might have actually left and become a swarm because they absconded from their original cavity or hive. And when they abscond, that means they're leaving because of disease. They're leaving because something is going on in that cavity that they were no longer going to tolerate. So it's not necessarily a reproductive swarm that you've collected, but one that could be leaving out of the instinct of self-preservation. So this has me rethinking what I'm doing with my own backyard beehive. So now, this coming year, I'm not buying in any packages at all. So I'm going to work exclusively with my bees that come through winter, and I'm also going to focus again back on exclusively the line of BeeWeaver bees. And then my own, of course, there'll be some open mating going on because when they split and the new queens fly out, they're going to take off and mate with who knows who, but hopefully fastest, strongest, healthiest drones and so on. But anyway, there's a lot going on with this. The weaver bees do a great job because what I do, as we get into winter now, we're finding dead bees on the landing boards. By the way, if you're new to beekeeping and this is your first winter, that's perfectly normal. There shouldn't be thousands of dead bees, but you should see, you know, 10 or 12 dead foragers that are on the landing board. The remnants of your male bees, the drones, should be also being tossed out if they haven't already been. And by the way, these cast-offs, this is what the yellow jacket wasps are eating right now. So, but I collect those and I wash them off and I find out if there's mites on them. I did this last year and it was a lot of fun. A lot of fun because it was very informative. I could take those mites, put them under a microscope, and then I could see, and again, here's where keeping notes comes in. When you take your Ziploc baggies out there and you get your little barbecue skewers and you reach into that opening and you scoop out those bees right into a Ziploc bag, the Ziploc bag gets marked with a Sharpie, the hive that it came from, because we want to see, really you can't do a mite count, but when you find varroa mites, in some cases still attached to the bodies of the dead bees. It's very rare for me to find that, but when I do find it, I get to get a really good look at how that mite is attached. It's always on the abdomen. It's always between one of the plates there. We get to look at the mites, and the mites that are just on the bottom of the solid bottom boards, when you scrape those out and you look at those, we get to look at the conditions of their feet and stuff. And guess what the BeeWeaver bees do? They chew their feet, like the Purdue ankle biters. That's one of their traits, is that they chew at the feet of the mites. And that's, so not only do they groom them off, they make it so the mites can't climb on things. Because, and this is what I'm going to get a really good look at this year under the microscope on a video, and I'm going to share it on my YouTube channel. So if you haven't subscribed, you want to go ahead and do that. And if you're confused about which of these videos you've already watched, just click the like button down there, and then you'll see it and you'll know that you've watched it. So I'm going to zip in on their little feet, and then I'm going to see the very soft, tacky little foot pad that they have. There's a scientific term for it. Tacky foot pad is what I'll call it for now. And I want to see if they've nipped off their feet, because in the absence of that, they lose their ability to grip onto things, to climb the wall of the interior of the hive, to get back on board with some of the other bees when they're trying to save themselves. They can't grip tight. They also found out, Randy Oliver did a pretty good study on how well they were attached under that plate. You know, are their mouth parts really dug in? Are there little hooks that really cling to the bee? Or can they actually groom off fairly easily? And he found out that they actually did groom off fairly easily. So they're not like ticks. When a tick digs in, you can pull that tick and its head can be left in the hole. This doesn't happen with the varroa mite. So anyway, I am still very happy with the bee weavers. They were not on the list of reputable varroa resistant hygienic bees being sold in the United States, which I found pretty interesting. And there are others, of course. They're still good. Purdue ankle biters comes to mind. But they're all known for different things. Anyway, I'm going to mention one of those distributors later on today. But I'm still happy with BeeWeaver overall, and I think that I sabotaged my own colonies by bringing in other bees that didn't handle mites well. They generated high numbers of mites, and then those, I feel, were passed on phoretically on the surface of other bees to the other colonies. And because it's the colonies adjacent to my high mite count colonies that ultimately required treatment as well. So this may be an issue of drift with the bees going between each landing board there and some of them getting in and, of course, bringing mites with them. So that's how mites get around. They get on the bees and they take off, and when that forager heads out, it's got a mite on it, and then it can transfer to another bee because, you know, they can't fly on their own, and they sure don't go hiking across the yard by themselves, so they need a physical contact transfer. Now, a bee can leave it on the flower. I've seen videos. I think Dr. Seeley, maybe Cornell, did videos where they showed that the mite was on flowers. And of course, this was in a controlled environment because they put these mites on flowers that had pollen on them, and it was in a plexiglass enclosure. And then when the bee landed on it, they showed how agile the mite was when it clambered onto that foraging bee, who then flew back to its original colony. And there we go. Now we have mites in that colony. So you're never going to be completely mite-free. But this is the recommendation I make for you if you're a brand new beekeeper starting out. And this winter, you're just getting all your stuff together and you're planning for the spring. So the sequence of your thought line should be, in my opinion, by the way, everything I say here is my opinion and my personal experiences with bees, or I'm going to cite the source of what I share with you. Get good stock of bees that's adapted to the area where you live and that has the traits that you want. Some people don't mind having to treat their bees, and that's okay. Other people would rather lean towards very little treatment to treatment-free, if that's even possible, and want to work with those lines. So that's when you research lines of reputable distributors and breeders of treatment-free or varroa-resistant survivor line bees. So the stock that you get is, number one, that's the baseline for everything that you're going to do with your bees. The next thing is really good quality hives that are placed well. And we find out that hives that are actually sit in winter sun do the best. That they have fewer small hive beetles, for example. That a beehive in the shade, in the woods, in damp areas, picks up more small hive beetles faster than hives that are sitting in the sun. Also, there are fewer pathogens and problems associated with hives that are parked in the sun, specifically in winter, and face south and southeast for the entrances, for the landing boards. And then other groups will say, of course, if you're going to put all your hives really close together, aim the landing boards all different directions. So can you say, well, now I can't do that because I have to have them all facing south or southeast. they just do better. It doesn't mean that they're going to fail if you have landing boards that are 180 out for each other. So depending on how your land is situated, you want your colonies to be as far apart from one another as you can place them. We have learned that the farther apart these colonies are, the less they're going to have drift. So the bee that I just described that would fly around with its varroa hitchhiker would not be landing on the wrong landing board and bringing that varroa into that next colony. So the farther apart that you can get your hives, the better. Because in the wild, this is one of the reasons that we think feral colonies do so well. It's because they're occupying spaces in trees that are often hundreds of yards away from each other, if not miles away from each other, or kilometers away from each other. So the farther apart they are, there's less sharing going on, so that one that's really loaded that wouldn't survive well on its own is not going to explode out and then, of course, affect and impact the health and overall well-being of another colony that's too close by. We know that drift happens all the time, especially the drones are just visiting everybody. Anyway, so, and also here's the other thing, clip your queen's wings. This is what I'm doing henceforth. I don't want my queens, when they swarm, flying out of the hive and taking off far afield, because I've followed them this year trying to see if I could keep up with them because they travel at 6 miles an hour. But when you start hitting brooks and rivers and huge fields and obstacles to climb over, you can't really keep pace with them until they land. Where if I would just clip the wings on one side of my queen, which I did at the end of the year, so all the new queens that are brought in, I clipped one side. What's it going to do for me? Will that prevent them from swarming? No, but when they do swarm, they're not going anywhere without the queen. So she's now going to fly lopsided. That's why you don't clip both wings, by the way, because then they can just rev up and kind of have a balance and take off. If one is clipped, and they kind of spiral to the ground, and then the rest of the swarm will stay with the queen on the ground, and then you can go out there, collect her, and rehive her, or do whatever it is you're going to do. If you remove that queen, the bees that are with her return to the hive that they emitted from. So I will be clipping all of my resident queens going into 2021 to prevent them from swarming, starting colonies well away. So instead, they'll be forced to land on something nearby so I can collect and rehive or just remove the queen if she's really old and non-productive or something like that. So greater control. And this is important for people that are living in urban areas where you have a lot of neighbors, you're in a residential area, or there's a residential area nearby. Clipping the queen will make sure that you're not generating a swarm and she flies off and gets up in somebody's soffit or something like that. The other thing is make sure that you inspect your colonies. And if you don't know how to do it, bring somebody in who's seen them that knows what they're looking for and get them to look at your bees with you until you know what to look for and how they're doing and whether or not any kind of treatment is required. It's not just varroa that we could be concerned about. There's a lot of other issues going on in hives that are a little more sophisticated that might not be so obvious to somebody who's looking at their bees for the first time. So getting a mentor is going to be really, really important. You can watch a lot of YouTube videos, but nothing's going to match someone coming to your apiary, looking at your bees with you and walking you through it step by step until you're comfortable and letting you know what to look for. What is healthy brood? You want to know when your brood's not healthy. You want to be very aware of things like European foul brood and American foul brood in particular, which is devastating. And you want to work with spring survivors after the year, which is what I'm going to do this year. Whoever doesn't do well through winter, whatever colonies are small, we're either going to, if I don't see any secondary infection or problems with those colonies, we're going to be combining them and I'm going to reduce my numbers and keep stronger colonies, healthier colonies, smaller numbers, and so on from there. So that's it. BeeWeaver, yes, are very good. Go to BeeWeaver, BeeWeaver.com. And if you buy a queen there, you can also go there and pick up packages and nucleus colonies, I believe. They don't ship them. Tell them I sent you so that you can be sure to pay the same as everyone else. Next one comes from Carl. How did you apply dielectric grease to the joints of your boxes? I have to open up my boxes this weekend to remove mite treatment strips. And the girls do have another few weeks, mid-60s, days back to lock down the hive for winter. So here's the thing. This is something I've talked about When we take apart our hives this time of year, because you have to look into them for one reason or another, you're going to break the propolis seal, all the same. And when you break that apart, the bees, when it gets cold, cannot reseal things up very well. So sometimes, especially as your equipment gets a little older, you look where the boxes come together and you can see an air gap through there. And just going into winter, that's not great. The bees would have sealed it up on their own. So this is the first winter that I'm going around. He says dielectric grease. I'm using silicone grease, which is different from silicone sealer. Silicone grease never sets. It's inert, and you can get food grade. That means it's designed to be used with food processing equipment. It's absolutely inert. This is what the question is we're dealing with. So I have this grease gun here, and I am using it for nothing but food grade silicone, and I'll put a link to this down in the video description below. But this has, of course, a rigid tip, where when you're using grease guns, you know, for vehicles and stuff, you'll see a flexible tip on it. And I should tell you that a lot of beekeepers, when they saw that this is what I was going to do, said, I don't use that stuff because I don't want it on my bee suits. Because when you get this on your bee suit, apparently it's tough to clean off. So I would just be very careful with it and not get it in the fabric of your clothes, because I can understand that. The very thing that makes it effective, the properties that make it effective, is when you squirt it in from the outside around those edges just enough to seal that joint. Then water and air won't get in through there. Like, I got that on my hand even right now. So yeah, you probably want to wear your, you know, nitrile gloves and stuff like that when you use it. But that's what I'm doing this year to seal those outside gaps and stuff just until spring. So if we're pulling our hives apart, we want to worry about exposing them to airflow and stuff, then that's something that you can do, and that's what this deals with. I have to open up my boxes. We're going to remove the mite treatment strips. By the way, if you're going to use mite strips, we recommend Mite Away Quick Strips. And BetterBee.com also sells those. They sell the current version of it. It has like a 2-year shelf life, so it actually is good for a little longer. Anyway, and you can use that with your honey supers on for those of you who have mites that are out of control and you're looking for some other kind of treatment. Once you have mites, you got to do something about it. Otherwise, you can lose a colony, create a mite bomb. They're going to, as I suspect happened in my own apiary, they're going to affect the other hives and require you to treat everybody. Here is the next question. I wonder who it's from here. Oh, this is from Peter from Virginia. I have 3 hives, and one I suspect won't make it through winter. Hive 1, on last inspection, only had 8 frames, occupied with bees and so on. I took frame 9 and 10, which were better comb. No signs of use of the better comb, and I replaced the 2 frames with insulation, the blue type, 2-inch. So there's this rigid foam board insulation that I suspect we're talking about, and it's 2 inches thick, and put it on the outside wall, got behind on mite control. That's why the hive is in trouble. Hive is only 1 deep, 10, 8 frame now. Okay, so we went from a 10 frame to an 8 frame because its insulation boards were installed inside the hive. I personally, and of course, this comes into, you know, a lot of beekeeping is opinion based. Here's my experience with foam insulation board, and it comes from the polystyrene hive covers. Insulation board, when the bees had access to it, when it was a cover and you have the inner cover and then the bees could go through that hole to the outer cover, I've had them actually chew away that material because they see it as a foreign material. Nothing natural about polystyrene or insulation board inside your hive. Nothing natural about plastic as far as that goes too. So, but the bees actively try to remove insulation material like polystyrene in my experience when it came to the hive cover in particular. So I think sticking insulation boards in lieu of the frames that were there inside the hive may not be a good move because the bees may treat it as a foreign material that they're trying to get rid of. So they'll do one of 2 things. They'll either try to cover it with propolis, which this time of year they can't do because it's too cold. or they'll try to chew it away bit by bit, and you'll see it, you know, chewed and carved out by the bees. So what we're doing now is potentially causing your bees inside the colony at a state when they need to be in torpor, when they need to be conserving their energy to get through winter. They could be actively having to remove a foreign material from the hive, being those insulation boards. So I think that better to leave the empty frames in there and have your, don't disrupt any of the established frames that they have worked, but I would leave those there. And if you really want to insulate, I would rather insulate the outside of the hive rather than putting insulation material inside the hive. And then it says, in spring, how do I rotate out old frames I got when they came as nukes? Well, once they've used it and once they've hatched their brood out of those frames, especially if they've moved up at all, that's when you can get rid of the frames, when they're no longer in them or when there's no longer any larvae in there, no pupae or larvae on the frame that you want. You can use a skateboard or something like that to get them out of there and then pull those frames. And it's a good practice generally to remove the oldest two. So we go with 20% of the frames per 10 frame box every 3 years or so. So you'll be cycling them out. So you do two. So that's six every 3 years if you do two a year. And just keep rotating out your oldest comb, because we have learned that honeycomb builds up detrimental amounts of pesticide. Fungicide is something else that's detrimental to the bees. All of that stuff starts to build up in the comb, especially as it gets older. And the comb starts out with a pesticide load. How does that happen? Well, because the bees metabolize the pesticide. And remember that when they're producing comb, they're making beeswax from their own bodies. So the material that they've been exposed to becomes part of the wax that they make. And then they compose it, and there it is. So rotate them out. Two of your worst frames every year as they start to get really dark. Because also they stop using them. You'll notice too, the queen will stop using some really old frames, really old comb, because it ultimately becomes too small. She doesn't lay eggs in it, so then they just start to use it for pollen storage and in some cases honey storage in the dark comb, and then they ultimately don't use it at all. So we have to rotate them out. Next is from Ricky. Hey Fred, I know how you said your horizontal hive did well this year, but could you give us an update? How many frames did the bees fill, and did you get any honey from this hive this year? Do you think the horizontal hive would do better in winter versus your vertical hives? Thanks for all you do. Okay, well, thanks for those compliments, by the way, Ricky, but here's the thing. And I'm gonna show you, these are the hive configurations that we currently have. The standard Langstroth hive right here, they are all well off the ground because we have skunk problems where I live. Deep box, medium box. The medium box is full of honey going through winter. Feeder shim, roof here on the standard Langstroth box. Now, of course, this year we put insulator roofs on all of them, but I wanted to show the differences. These are the three hive designs that we have. Long Lang horizontal hive, and then the Lay-ins hive, which really is kind of in between the Long Lang and the vertical because it has huge frames and is very unique to that. But how did my bees do? So we're going in the first winter, so this is, time will tell. We had 11 frames that were considered all capped honey. So that is about, if we figure out about 7 pounds, give or take, on a fully capped deep frame, both sides. And so we're looking at 60 to 70 pounds of honey going into winter on that Long Lang, which is 27 to 31 and 3/4 kilograms. So the other thing is we had 7+ frames of brood, honey, and pollen. We also had 3 end frames. So when we pull out the divider board and started looking at the ends, that was only partially full of capped honey. So we've got a total of 20 frames in the Long Lang, which is pretty standard for their first year of development. And the population is really good. And so we'll know more in spring when we do a spring inspection and we see how well they build up. Now I could have removed those last 3 frames that are partially full, but I'm leaving them in. Just going to see what happens there. They have no signs of pests. They have no signs of small hive beetles and things like that, which would go after their comb that's kind of out of their reach and the stored resources out of the bees' reach. And the other thing is we did not have any issues with wax moth larvae and things like that too. So those bees are policing the interior of that extremely well. They have a single entrance. They have created their own propolis envelope throughout the whole thing. And we're going to know more in the spring. So are they better than the vertical long or the vertical Langstroth standard hive configuration? Not necessarily. Their frames are the same. The horizontal format offers advantages to people that can't lift things. That's why the horizontal hive is good. I see the vertical hives as more productive if you can physically handle the boxes, if you can physically pull them off and do inspections and don't mind all of that, then the vertical hives tend to do better. But this is my first year with a long horizontal hive, so you know I may not be qualified to give you that opinion. And a lot of people are going horizontal hives exclusively. So for my vertical hives, all my honey supers are flow hive supers. So even if I have standard Langstroth boxes from Better Bee or wherever, Man Lake, whoever, the honey supers will all be flow supers in my apiary. And the others will be the Ross Rounds comb honey supers. So I don't do any uncapping, extracting, spinning, and all that stuff anymore. So for the long Langstroth, let me tell you that what's fun about the long Langstroth hive or the horizontal format in general, it is the easiest thing ever to inspect. When you build it, when you position it perfect for your inspections, for your height, whatever height you want that to be. And plus it's so long and so large, I made mine 5 feet long. It has its own storage area built in. All my stuff is sitting right there. Guess what else I'm doing now? Part of biosecurity, maybe it's overkill, maybe it isn't, but I don't have to go hunting for my hive tools, because what I've done is I'm assigning hive tools to every hive. So when you pull off the outer cover, which you don't need a hive tool to open, it's the inner cover that you need a hive tool to open, I'm going to have a hive tool sitting right in there, and every single colony will have its own tool. That way I'm not doing any cross-contamination of any of my beehives. Maybe that's overkill, but if you fail safe, it's definitely not detrimental to have a hive tool in every single one of your hives sitting on top of that inner cover. And these horizontal hives, because they're stationary, they can be as heavy as they want, they're nice and thick, as heavy and bulky as you want them to be, as insulated as you want them to be. The one that I just got from Dr. Leo Sherishkin is insulated with woolen, so that's my lay-ins hive. It's all weatherproofed and everything else. So there's room for you to have your gear right there. You could even probably have a smoker hidden in there if you wanted to. I don't see any point in that. But the stuff that's going to be in contact with your bees, like your hive tool, can actually be spreading. Can you tell I'm learning more about pathogens and hives? But anyway, 20 frames is what they did, pretty standard. So we look for them to build up even more next year, and then we're going to see how they go. So, but I can't say the one's better than the other. Definitely, I have no configuration ideas to put flow supers in a horizontal format. And with the lay-ins hive, those frames are huge. And the reason I'm looking at those is because I'm going to be able to observe an uninterrupted brood pattern the way the bees would do it on their own, because the frames are much deeper. A standard Langstroth frame is only so deep. And I was watching a video this morning, Mr. Ed, Jeff Horschel bees, and they were doing a rip out and they were going through the floor joists. And I don't get a lot of time to look at other people's videos, and the guy is so enthusiastic. But what was really interesting is that's technically a horizontal long Langstroth hive between those joists. Because if those are 2x10s, that's a 9.5 inch space from the subfloor interior through that. So they are actually, that's a long Langstroth hive right there. So the bees actually do occupy spaces like that on their own, if they can get to them. So it's very interesting to see what bees left of their own. So that tells us, he said in his video that those had been there for a year, he thinks. And, you know, they had gotten out at another time and reoccupied it or whatever. But so in a year's time, that looked like a very healthy setup, a very healthy hive. The floor was clean, everything was clean. I think the horizontal format works. So we're going to find out. Next comes from Mary. Hey Fred, I'm planning on getting another hive in spring. I currently have a flow hive too, and I'm getting a long hive which I plan to fill with a split from my flow. So we're going to start with one colony, let it build up, divide that colony, make another. Calling there, do you recommend keeping the queen in the float or moving the queen to the new hive with the split? I always recommend taking the old queen and establishing her in your new hive once they've shown that they are developing queen cells and that they have what they need to replace the old queen when she leaves. And to reduce the chance of the flow hive swarming. And that's what I want to tie into again. If you're living in an area where you're worried about swarming and you want to be a good steward to your neighbors and make sure that your bees are not taking off, clip those wings on the right-hand side or the left-hand side, just one side or the other. Anyway, and then the rest of the question is, can't move the position of the hives around. Would I be better off splitting into a nuke box first, then moving the nuke gradually back to where the long hive is going to be in, and then transfer the bees? So thank you very much. And this is from Devon, UK. So anyway, no, there's no reason to start with a nucleus, because with these horizontal hives, you've got a follower board in there. So you decide how big that interior space is. It's another thing that's absolutely cool about that horizontal format, by the way. If you start with four or five frames in there, then that's right where your divider board is, and that's all the space they have. And the single entrance is right there. So then as you expand, then instead of adding boxes, now you're just adding frames. It's super convenient. And guess where those extra frames can be staged? On the other side of your divider board in that big open space there. And then, oh, look, they're expanding. They need more space. Let me just pull my divider board over and put some of these frames in over here and let them build out. And in my horizontal hive, I used the better comb. And then I had foundationless, better comb, foundationless. And you can't tell the difference other than they left the bottom open where they transit through. So no, I would not put a nuke box, a nucleus box, which is a really small standalone box. I would have my horizontal hive all set up where it's going to be ultimately, and that's where I would start them, right in it. That's what I would do. The less you diddle around with reconfiguring what they're living in, the more likely they are to really set up house and accept the space that you've given them. So that's my answer to that. This one comes from Richard. Let's see. Is it healthy to make a beehive out of styrofoam insulation board? And if so, what would be the safest to use? Well, here's the other thing about styrofoam insulation board. First of all, it's probably not built for beehives. I mean, I understand it's probably easy to put together and stuff. And the R factor would be really high, probably. But I'm going to suggest, rather than building your own, if you're really thinking of the insulation type polystyrene, go with one of the kits that already exist, because they're really not that expensive. And there's two really standout ones. The B-Max is one that comes. They have all the polystyrene kits ready to go. And Lyson. And those are also, I'm directing you back to Better Bee. They sell them on Amazon and all kinds of places. But they're much tougher. When you see what that material is like, I use the B-Max lids only on all my hives this winter, all the Langstroth-style hives, because we're going to keep those insulated. I got some really good feedback from someone else today via email that the insulated hive, they're tracking the humidity inside and outside of the hive, the temperatures inside and outside, and they're noticing that the condensation, just like I said, is forming on the sidewalls of the hive, not the interior surface, directly over the cluster of the bees. So that's actually going to work really well. But I highly recommend, instead of trying to make them yourself, buy the ones that are already configured, because they're not that expensive. They're super ready to go. You're not going to be gluing everything up. The chances for failure are less. I don't use those because, first of all, 500-year half-life in landfills. So if you're trying to live green, you know, that's a hard sell for me. They're super lightweight. We just had 60 to 70 mile an hour wind gusts going through my bee yard this past week. And that was intense. Trees were whipping over. Everybody was out without power. Not me. We had power. And I saw one polystyrene lid take off across the back field. So, of course, I run out there in the storm because I think one of my hives blew apart, but it wasn't. It was one of my, it was a staged lid that was not part of a hive with bees in it. So everyone had shipping straps holding them together. But the reason I bring this up is polystyrene is a super lightweight hive. Super lightweight. So until your bees build up in it, until they start to load their resources and really pack the weight on, it's one of the things I like about wooden hive configurations is they have physical weight already. So even my feeder shims that I put in there, those things are heavy. That's like 15 pounds added to the hive right there. I like a heavy built hive. And let me tell you what hive is going absolutely nowhere. That long Langstroth horizontal hive, because it took two of us to carry it out there to put it on the stand. Those things are heavy, and that's another attribute in my mind. I think the bees are more comfortable in a structure that doesn't vibrate like crazy every time the wind picks up. I think because we have to consider that they would otherwise be in the hollow of a tree, and that tree is going to move a little bit when the wind starts moving the branches and everything. But the resonance, the vibrating that goes through the wood of the tree would probably be much reduced. So, but if you're going to go with polystyrene, I highly recommend just buying one that's already ready to go. Lots of companies sell them, but the top two, in my opinion. Oh, the other thing is the apomite hives. So those of you who have those might want to chime in and share what you like about them. But that's another one, super insulated. So for those who want to go that route, Cayman Reynolds. I haven't seen him do any updates on his apomite hive recently, but he would be another person to check in with to see how things are going. The next question, Susanna says, let's see, thanks for wonderful information. I'm trying some of your and Dr. Seeley's recommendations for one garden hive this winter, including a single bottom entrance, top insulation, southern exposure, southeast exposure, full stores in half deep honey super, atop a single deep. While not on your recommendation, I have also added a waxed cardboard covering as an insulation wrap. This folds over the top of the inner cover and the outer cover slides down on top. Is this going to be overkill? I'm a little concerned if it will limit airflow and cause excess moisture inside the hive, but I'm slightly more worried about losing the bees to fierce wind and cold this winter. Lander, Wyoming, agricultural zone 4B. So I'm Ag Zone 4 here too. I don't know what 4B is specifically. But no, it's not overkill to have, you know, one of these wraps, core flute or whatever it's made out of. Some of them have Velcro straps that go with them and everything that go around the outside of the hive. And they have cutouts for that entrance. And I think most of them are black in color, which would make sense because then they can take advantage of the solar heat when the sun hits them. So I don't think it's overkill. It's not always necessary. So here's another thing that I like to do personally, is if I were going to try that and find out, is there more condensation in one that isn't? But all things kind of have to be equal for that to work out. So you would have a hive that's wood without the insulation wrap around the outside, and then you'd have another colony that does have that. And then you have to have a way to measure the moisture percentages inside and the condensation, humidity, temperature, and everything else, and see what the differences are. Because especially when we get those warm-ups, like today, for example, if the hive were well insulated, you would have more condensation inside than the hives that are less insulated when we have these warm-ups. And often people that are part of our Beekeepers Association that use the heavily insulated hives find that there's more condensation in those when they have the other hives to compare with. And it's important to make these comparisons in your own apiary because all other conditions have to be the same in order for this to be, you know, measurable and really comparable. You have to know that the environment's the same, that the heating and cooling is the same, and that the amount of groundwater in the area, the amount of humidity is all the same to know that one configuration either does or doesn't work better than the other. So definitely I would use these big insulated hives if I were way far north. There are people that are keeping bees and it gets 20 below and stuff like that. I don't get temperatures like that, but of course, make sure that your hive is tilted towards the entrance. If everything else is insulated and everything else, if there is condensation inside, then it should follow the interior walls. It should not be building up on the interior surface of your insulated cover. If it did, worst case scenario, if it were tipped, then those drips would hopefully trail along that interior surface and down the front rather than if the hive were perfectly level, condensation building up and dripping down directly on the bees, which is the number one thing you want to avoid. So, but more insulation is not necessarily overkill, and a single entrance is fine, according to Dr. Seely. So we're going to see how that goes this winter. But I think you're okay, but it would be neat to have at least two colonies configured differently so you can make a comparison as to how well one did over the other. The honeybees themselves generate so much moisture inside a hive. It is significant. Anyway, the next question here, JF. One thing I do find is that certain subjects are being repeated again and again, I presume because people continue to ask more or less the same questions again and again. That's true, we do repeat ourselves here sometimes, me repeat myself sometimes. That's because some of the questions are worth repeating, I think, because that's how we learn. You hear the same thing kind of over and over, especially when it's effective, when it works. But he also says here that I would like to promote the very well put together playlists that are available on this channel. And that's true, we have playlists. So, for example, this entire series, questions and answers for backyard beekeepers, this is, you know, we're in the 80s now, and all of those are in a single playlist. So the advantage of a playlist is once you click on and save the playlist, anytime a new video gets answered, like today's video, it automatically gets added to the playlist. So if you fall behind or you miss some or whatever, it will continue to play them in order for you. And I have playlists for the flowhive experience, playlists for beekeeping equipment to consider. We have pest playlists and all this other stuff. So that's absolutely true. You would have to go to my YouTube channel, look at the playlists. There's a little tab right there. You click on that and it shows all the playlists associated with my channel because some of them deal with chickens and other things. So that's true. And I'm sorry that some of our stuff is repetitive. I try to accept and work with questions that I think are either really pertinent to the time of year that we're dealing with right now, or something maybe that's new or that I need to make a correction of. Some people are going backwards because they realize that maybe I've modified my beekeeping methods and arrived at something better. So they're looking at the newest episodes first and then working back. So, which is interesting too. Anyway, what is the chain of command with the honeybees? Most of us probably already know about the importance of the healthy queen with good genes, the life of the worker, bee climbing through the ranks and the drones, job two. But how does the colony as a whole make its decisions? That is a very complex answer because here's the other thing. Eusocial insects like the honeybees, they have multiple jobs going on at once. So for example, it's not a lockstep progression where one nurse bee may be a nurse bee for the first 10 days, while another bee generated from the same colony may be a nurse bee for 5 days and then go right into something else. So these jobs overlap, and some of them never do some of the jobs in the hive. Not every bee becomes a guard bee, for example. Not every bee becomes an undertaker bee that takes out the dead bees. And the division is really interior jobs where they don't go anywhere, and then they migrate to transitional jobs to where they ultimately end up going outside and being foragers and things like that. But the best way to find out how things are decided by the bees, how they make their decisions collectively, is with Dr. Tom Seely's book. It is called The Honeybee Democracy. That is the best book that I know of that really describes the process of how bees are making decisions. And what you're going to learn quickly is the queen is really a servant to the colony. The nurse bees and the workers are making all of the decisions about how the queen does what she does, where she does it, how she's fed, how she's groomed, and when they're sick of her and decide to kick her out. So these things are collective decisions. It's a super organism where the bees all act at specific times in their lives during certain jobs. They all act as a collective when decisions are made inside and outside the hive when they swarm. So The Honeybee Democracy by Dr. Tom Seely. I'll put a link to that book down below. And I think I have it on Audible Books too. So if you like to do other things and listen to books while you drive, while you're stuck in traffic or whatever, that's the best thing to do. So that will give you real insight. And all of Dr. Seely's books, The Wild Bee, The Biology of the Bee, he's done lots of things that will teach you about how they come to their decision as honeybees, a superorganism. Next comes from John McNeil. Fred, you mentioned green drone frames for varroa control. Does the queen choose to lay drones in the largest cells, or is there a trigger of some sort that tells her to lay drones in any larger cell? Is there a time when drone laying is predominant? Yes. And again, this is where the queen is a servant to the workers. The queen is inspecting every cell before she lays an egg in it. So if it's a small worker cell, then this is all made by the wax workers inside that colony, and it is sized to the bees. And so this is what happens. You often see the worker cells are through the field, through the center of the colony, and predominantly you will only find the drone comb, the drone cells, which are larger, and the worker bees decide how many of those they need. When do they build them? They build the larger cells when they have a high rate of reproduction, when they have a high rate of health and well-being inside the colony, and they decide that they're going to expand, that they might decide to give birth to another colony or just spread their genetics out there. So they start in the outlying frames building drone comb. How much drone comb would there be on average in a 10-frame deep colony? There would be roughly 20%. So two frames out of 10 could end up being almost all drone cells. So then when we have these foundations, you get the foundations that are pre-stamped for the sizes for worker foundation. And then there are these big green one-piece frames, which I looked for and couldn't find. I would have shown it to you. But they have larger cells stamped in them. So we're dictating to the workers that if you draw a comb on this acorn heavy waxed frame, you're going to have to make these big cells, because now we're going to make sure that you're making big drone comb, and it's also a green frame, so it's very distinctive when you're doing an inspection. Why on earth does that frame exist? Why would we make them make these large cells? The queen is going to do drones, and those drones aren't going to heat the colony. They're not going to defend the colony. They're going to eat our resources, and all they're going to do is fly out and supposedly mate with virgin queens someday if they're super lucky and they're super fit and they fly super fast on the day that the queen just happens to go out and do her maiden flight. So, well, the reason is it's varroa control. It's a method of natural varroa control, and people can reduce a third of the varroa numbers by timing that. And here's where people kind of mess it up, to be honest. They put those in with great intentions. They put those drone frames in there, and they're going to pull them out. You know, once they're capped, all your casts of bees, whether it's a worker, whether it's a drone, whether it's a queen, they end up being capped between the 9th and 10th day, so then they're in the pupa state. And the kick is that drones are bigger. Drones have a longer pupa state than the other bees in the colony, and that's why they're so appealing to the varroa mites. And those varroa mites zip their buns right in there within 48 hours of that cell being capped, and they're going to reproduce in there, and they're going to hide. Because also that big fat drone larva is nice and big and has lots of hiding places. So they're going to reproduce in there, and they get a longer time to reproduce because the drone takes the longest to hatch out of there. And then so people are supposed to pull that out before the 24th day, since it was an egg, and they forget. Next thing you know, all your drones are hatching, and you just got this great nursery for new varroa destructor mites. So if you're going to use it for control, don't forget to pull them out and feed them to your chickens. The other thing is, yes, it's triggered. The queen, first of all, when resources are coming in, everything is going well, the queen decides whether she's going to do a haploid or a diploid, if she's going to lay an infertile egg, which is haploid, if she's going to lay a fertile worker, which is diploid, then that infertile egg becomes a male, which is really weird. If it's infertile, why did it even hatch? So anyway, that becomes the drone, and the queen decides if she's going to let that egg go, because when the eggs are traveling down through that queen's reproductive system, and she either decides through the spermatheca, where all that sperm is stored from all those wild nights she had when she was a virgin queen, and as that little egg comes out, oh, she fertilized that one, worker, not fertilizing this one, it's going in a large cell, that's going to be a drone, who's just going to be a consumer, who's just going to sit around, but ultimately be kicked off that cliff, you know, the end of his life if he doesn't ever get to mate. The drone wants to die. He wants to die after mating with a virgin queen. So it's a stimulus that comes from the cell size, and then the queen decides when she's producing an egg whether or not she's going to fertilize it. What's a fertilized egg going to produce? Diploid. What's a non-fertilized egg going to produce? A drone. Haploid. Anyway, moving right along. The next one is Mad Dog 7. Let's see. As we are beyond feeding at this time, how would one supply Hive Alive to the bees? Earlier in the fall with syrup? Or wait till February-ish? Or is there a way to do so during winter? Hive Alive. Oh, man. And I have my Hive Alive. Anyway, Hive Alive, I mentioned in a previous video, it is a feed supplement. There are a lot of feed supplements out there, most of them not supported by underlying scientific studies that have proved their effectiveness or not. So Hive Alive, I talked about because I read articles about it and I read the studies. And it did show that, number one, it improves their overall weight, the microgut biome, the gut microbiome, and helps them with nosema. So we have two types of nosema that the bees find themselves concentrated with in wintertime. So this stuff, Hive Alive, works on several levels to improve the overall health and well-being of the bee. And then the end of that study will say, further research necessary. So further validation. So there has been some scientific study, some positive results, and then further research necessary. But it is the only thing in that category that has proven to work that way. So it's for nosema. What if we wanted to deliver that to the bees? Well, you can put it in their syrup, which is how it's designed. And then what if you're going to feed solids now this time of year? Well, you blend it with, if you're making fondant, you include it in your fondant. If you're going to do sugar bricks, which means it's just sugar and water with such a high sugar content that it just solidifies and becomes a block of granulated sugar. So you would mix that in at the same rate. So it would be 10 milliliters per gallon, I believe. And then so you put that in there, blend it really well, and let it become crystallized with the sugar. And then you just feed that in your rapid round or up in your feeder shim, however you decide to deliver it. So it can be mixed with those recipes for the solidified feeds that you're giving to your bees in wintertime. And then in spring, we go back to 1:1, and you can do that. When would nosema levels be the highest? It would be the highest in spring and midwinter, because that's when they are not getting out and they're holding everything. But again, not every bee has nosema. So, and nosema serrana is the one that most of them are infected with. Which, by the way, listen to this. Nosema apis is a very tiny percentage of your colonies in the United States could get that. It's roughly around 1%, so it's almost a non-entity as far as what your bees cope with. Most colonies clear it up on their own anyway, but Nosema serrana actually does not cause them to have diarrhea inside the hive, which is interesting. So it's a gut bacteria that has a negative impact on the bees' health and well-being, but it does not cause them to soil the entire interior of your hive the way some other stuff does. So that's interesting too. Next one here. This is from Fred S. Hi, Fred, for all the great content. Well, thank you for the great content. Let's move on. It says, my question is around honey crystallization. My honey has all begun to crystallize, which surprises me. I have a jar of honey a fellow beekeeper friend of mine in Florida gave me over the winter old, and it's just now beginning to crystallize. Is honey crystallization after just a few months typical? I have been keeping the jars of honey in my basement, which stays pretty consistently in the high 60s during summer. That's not cold enough. We're going to talk about that. I'm wondering if it might be because the honey might include sugar syrup. These last couple of years, I've heavily fed 2-to-1 sugar syrup to my bees into the fall to make sure they had enough resources going into winter. While I tried to avoid it, it is possible that some of the frames I extracted this year included frames where the bees had stored sugar syrup in the past couple of years. Do you think that might be the reason? Or perhaps some of the honey was already too cold or too old, left over from the first or second season. We're going to talk about this today. This honey is still liquid. See that? No great surprise. By the way, this is raw honey, unfiltered, unprocessed. It's not pasteurized. It's not raised in temperature or anything else. And then we're going to pick up this other jar here. That is crystallized honey. It is solid. You want to know what's interesting about this? These were drawn off the hives, different hives, same time. Where have they been stored? Same environment, same treatment, same amount of filtering, no filtering. And so it goes right from flow hives right into the jar, and this one crystallized. Why on earth did it do that? Well, for this particular instance, between these two jars, it has to do with the floral source. So when you get near the end of the year, and we've got goldenrod, and we've got asters, these things are really known to crystallize early. And by the way, they can crystallize, they can start crystallizing in just a couple of weeks. Got another little jar of it right here. It's not bad, it's the same honey, but it leads me to talk about some other things. So this is likely clover honey. Clover honey really does a good job of not crystallizing. So what I did is I looked up some information because I thought this is something that people are going to want to know about this time of year. How to avoid crystallization with your honey. Well, one of the things you can do, I don't know if you realize this, but supposedly when rain falls out of the air or snowflakes fall, a snowflake doesn't just form on air itself. A snowflake actually forms some little particulates in the air as it comes down. So it has to attach itself to something. Now, honey is a lot the same way, and that's why some of this honey that comes from asters and goldenrod and things like that, when you're doing raw, unprocessed, unfiltered honey, there are more particulates in suspension in that jar of honey for the crystals to form on and for your honey to become solidified. So that's one thing. So what could you do to reduce the chances that your honey is going to crystallize? By the way, we have friends that only want honey like this. They don't even want it clear and runny like that. So there are some parameters that I want you to know about. First of all, what if you wanted to filter your honey? Let me just show you my sheet here. If you had a 300 micron filter, by the way, they come in little bags, nylon bags, 14, 16 inches long, 6 inches in diameter. You can pour your honey through that. If it's 300 microns, guess what it's going to remove from your honey? Some of the things that a lot of people want in their honey, like bits of pollen and stuff. 300 microns will filter pollen. So if you take that out of suspension, you just took away one of the things that causes your honey to crystallize. So I'm gonna let you look at this sheet for a second. If you wanna freeze frame or take a screenshot or whatever it is you do to get this information. And then now we're gonna go over it. You want to avoid temperatures greater than 59 degrees Fahrenheit. So in this here in the basement, the temperature was above, it's in the 60s or more. So what happens there is, over time, it doesn't mean that your honey's going to spoil, but your honey modifies, by the way. Older the honey is, the darker it actually becomes, too. And guess what? The sugars even go through changes. It's still honey. But if you're trying to keep it in its purest form with the flavor fresh as possible, there are some things you should know. So we avoid temperatures that are above 59 degrees Fahrenheit or above 15 degrees Celsius. The honey will darken with age, and the sugars may modify themselves. Granulation is promoted at 10 to 15 degrees Celsius or 50 to 59 degrees Fahrenheit. So here you are, you put it in your root cellar or whatever, and you've got 50 to 59 degrees. You're thinking that you're slowing things down, but you're not. Crystallization is promoted. That doesn't mean your honey gets ruined, but it means that if it's unfiltered, not pasteurized, which some people do with honey, which is why some honeys all taste the same. Everything gets destroyed. But 50 to 59 degrees actually promotes this crystallization. Above 27 degrees Celsius or 81 degrees Fahrenheit, rapid deterioration of your honey occurs. Color, flavor, and enzyme become altered and damaged at those higher temperatures. So when you're drawing off honey, and a lot of people heat their honey before they go into processing. Why? Because it moves faster. These are commercial companies. This is why if you get jars of Subi honey or any of these high production honey companies, every jar of honey tastes the same as the one before and after it. It's highly filtered. It's highly processed. It goes through. Why do they crank up the temperature so high? Why do they go through a pasteurization process? Because they're trying to make sure that that honey, no matter its condition, will never spoil. So they need to kill the yeast. There is yeast in the air everywhere, and it can settle on sugars, and it can interact with that and cause fermentation. So that's one of the ways they destroy all the yeast in the honey when it's going through bottling. It makes sense. But if we're after raw honey and we want to preserve that floral source flavor and we want it to be as close to original as we can, we want to avoid temperatures 27 Celsius or 81 degrees Fahrenheit or hotter, rapid deterioration of your honey occurs. The other thing is, this is the target zone for your moisture percentage in your honey. Above 18.6% may ferment. It doesn't mean it will. We know that above 19% it will ferment because it's that combination of having more water, having yeast around that will cause that to ferment. Also, your honey, even once it's solidified, if that was too high a moisture content, when it crystallized, can still, you can smell it, can smell sour. It can also ferment. So below, this is interesting too, below 15.5% moisture. Actually, if this was being judged for honey composition, moisture composition below 15.5 is points off. So your optimum zone for your moisture content in your honey is between 15.5 and 18.6% moisture. Very interesting. Now, of course, you want to know, well, what temperature do I have to store it at to keep that honey as fresh and unaltered as possible for the longest possible time? The threshold is below 10 degrees Celsius or 50 degrees Fahrenheit. That preserves the flavor. It also prevents it from fermenting. Below 50. That's why some people say if they've got honey in frames that they didn't get a chance to extract, go ahead and put that right in a freezer or something like that, because then it will not crystallize. So that's true, but I don't know who has all that freezer space for all of this. But we know our target zone to prevent crystallization and to prevent alteration of the honey is anything below 50 degrees Fahrenheit or 10 degrees Celsius. Get it below that, you're good to go. By the way, when you put your honey in the freezer, it really doesn't freeze. It just gets arrested because honey is a highly viscous liquid that doesn't freeze at the same temperature water does. So below 50. I hope that's helpful. And that's it for storage tips to extend the life of it. And don't forget, use those silica dry packs if you're putting this stuff in hive butlers and things like that, which I am. That's where I stored my full frames of honey this year that are capped. And they're in the cold, wise dry silica packs. These things are working fantastic. And just update on that. And I do, I put them in the microwave and we dry them back out. When they turn dark colors, then they turn a light yellow color again and they go right back into service. I had no idea how much moisture was really occurring in storage with my honey. So it's very interesting. Next is from Antatic. Let's see, I purchased a piece of land for my apiary. I've seen some groundhogs around. I smelled some skunk stink around too. I know that skunks can attack on my bees, but do not know about groundhogs and raccoons. Any advice is appreciated. Okay, so here's the thing. We know that skunks, I'm in skunk heaven around here apparently. We have groundhogs, which are actually marmots. Those are ground squirrels, whistle pigs. There's a lot of different names for them. But they tunnel out. The average groundhog hole, a groundhog excavates over 700 pounds of dirt to make an average-sized woodchuck den. That's interesting. Also, coming up this year, side, fluff information, Punxsutawney Phil, the Groundhog Day groundhog, they will not be having a gathering there this year for that coming up, thanks to COVID restrictions. So anyway, the skunks, we know, do go after the bees. They eat them at night. If they can get to the landing board, they scratch the landing board and they eat them. There's lots of videos about that that I've generated. And I've observed that behavior. We know that your landing board needs to be 16 inches or higher off the ground in order to keep skunks from eating them. We also have some of the fattest raccoons I've ever seen moping around. They don't have anything to do with the bees at all. If you've had raccoon incidents where they did something with your beehives, I would love to hear about it. I have cameras everywhere. I'm spotting the wildlife. We put ivory deodorant soap bars on little trees that the deer were eating. And that's to keep the deer away, and that worked. But the funny thing was, I had a skunk come up to a really short little bush, and it actually ate Irish Spring deodorant soap. Ate it. Came back over three different nights, chewed at the soap, pulled it off of the zip tie that it was held on there with, because I took this bar of soap, drilled a hole in it, ran a zip tie through it, hang it on the tree. That skunk eats soap. Anyway, why did I tell you that story? I don't know. But so the skunks are the issue. You can defeat them completely just by elevating the landing board of your hives. The raccoons don't seem to care a hoot about the bees. And woodchucks definitely don't have anything to do with the bees. But here's what the woodchucks do that I don't like. Because I grow thousands of sunflowers for the bees, and we're planting different wildflower varieties, milkweed and stuff like that. And a woodchuck will go out there and clear out hundreds of them in a morning. So woodchucks are detrimental to the things that feed your bees because they just like to eat everything. They're herbivores. They just munch everything. So, but they are not going to impact your bees at all. They might attack the plantings that you're growing. Raccoons, no problem. So there's that. Now we're at the fluff end. Everything's done. We answered the questions. So now I'm just going to talk about a few extra things here. A lot of people are being told that they have to wear masks right now. In fact, they're going to go to a national thing. We're going into Thanksgiving, and they want everybody to stay home. But here's the thing. I wanted to tell you that my Teespring, I have honeybee masks. And this one has a queen bee. I photographed her on the comb in my observation hive. So because, to me, it's kind of a funny tie-in. Because the queen bee, of course, is constantly cleansed and constantly looked after, and the bees are licking and cleaning her and protecting her from any outside bacteria. Nobody gets to touch the queen except for baby bees that have never left the hive. And also we have the antibacterial property of the comb of the hive and the propolis and everything else. And so these are double thick fabric. And Bill Nye the Science Guy said, if you're going to get a mask over your face, it's going to be effective. It has to pass the candle test, which means you hold a candle a foot from your face and you try to blow as hard as you can through your mask and see if you can affect the flame on the candle or blow it out. If you can't, your mask is probably good to go. So these pass that test, and then some. And I also have some that say the way to be and everything else. So there's that. The other thing is make sure you're feeder shims are on, ready to go as an emergency, just in case they get through all their feed. Also, make sure to leave your entrance reducers on. If you're in the northern part of the United States right now, the wasps are still out there, as I showed at the beginning of this video. They are trying to get inside the hives. This year, most of them are after nectar, but of course, now I see these queens chewing up the bees. They're still partially alive, but they're cast out. So what they're doing is, the wasps are not attacking a landing board, attacking healthy worker bees, and dispatching them. They're getting the bees that are already not making it, that are on the ground, that are at the end of their life. The scary ones, of course, would be, I mean, insects don't have fear. There's evidence they don't feel pain. So, you know, but we look at them and we transfer our own feelings onto the bees. So you've got honeybees on the landing board. It's still cold enough that they can't fly yet. And here comes the wasp that can fly because for some reason they fly colder than the bees do. And then this bee that otherwise would recover and fly later gets set upon by a wasp and she starts to work it over. And they chew off the head and get rid of it. And, you know, not to be graphic, but that's what's going on in the opening sequences. So entrance reducers need to stay on to protect those bees, because the wasps are getting in. Also, be prepared to clean out your dead bees at every chance this time of year. They're going to be on the bottom. Get in there and scoop them out every chance you get to make sure that entranceway is clear. They're going to ventilate through that. They're going to haul out their dead through that. And on the warmer days, they're going to come and go through that. Make sure if you haven't tilted your hives already that they are tilted, that they're strapped down for heavy winds. And shipping straps will also protect your hives from bears if they knock them over. It's a big help because now you've got a hive intact on its side instead of all the boxes apart, which could be the end of the world for your bees. Examine the bodies, save them. This is what I'm doing because, of course, I want to do these micro videos and micro photos of the bees. We did this a little bit last year. Get Ziploc baggies. This is part of your record keeping too. Get sandwich bags, Ziploc baggies, and mark them with hive numbers. And then when you're scooping off and you're scraping out those dead bees on the landing board, scoop them right into your Ziploc baggie and save them so you can evaluate them. If something happens to the hive, it'll maybe inform you as to what was going on with that hive. But if you have access to a dissection style stereo microscope or something, I found out in my town, even the public library offers resources like that. So anyway, you have choices to preserve them by freezing them, or you can put those bees and keep them all separate again, and then you can keep them in isopropyl alcohol. But it's an opportunity to look at them, and if you find varroa, then you can see the condition of the varroa. Do you have bees that are actually chewing their feet? So there are a lot of things. You can also get handheld magnifying glasses that work pretty cool. Look at the jeweler style magnifying glasses, and they will help you look at those things very close. So collect the dead bees and take a chance to look them over. And finally, I want to talk about another YouTuber who does bees. He's a commercial beekeeper. His name is Cayman Reynolds. He is hosting a bee conference called Hive Life. That is coming up on January the 8th and 9th of 2021. So if you are on YouTube right now, which most of you are, just type in Cayman Reynolds, go to his YouTube channel, and you'll see his Hive Life video where he tells you what's going to be going on there. He did invite me to go. I was really excited about it, but I can't go. So I plan to attend Hive Life in 2022. So I'll get to go and be there. My wife is going to go with me. But, you know, I'm falling for a prank because then she's going to make me go and visit relatives all over Georgia and everywhere else. But so there is a bee conference coming up, Hive Life, January 8th and 9th of 2021, Cayman Reynolds. Go to his site. He's got a link down in the video description. You can click on that and register for it. It's going to be a lot of good people there talking about backyard beekeeping, commercial beekeeping. You can buy stuff and you get to just talk the talk and have a good time hanging out with beekeepers. I asked him about COVID restrictions. Are they... You know, is that going to lower their numbers and stuff? I think he said there'll be about 300 people there, and they are doing distancing and all that stuff or whatever, but apparently it's still going to go on. So that's it for today. I want to thank you for watching. Again, I look forward to seeing your own questions down below, and I hope you have a fantastic weekend.